pituitary retina in the form of vitreous traction or fibrovascular proliferation causing traction on the retina, subretinal traction in the form of bands and sheets, intraretinal traction due to intrinsic retinal shortening, and one needs to ensure good hemostasis all throughout surgery and prevent future possibility of neovascularization by tight PRP and use endodiaphragms judiciously. Conventionally, membrane peeling was done with intravitreal forceps, scissors and spatulas, with which the membranes were delaminated, segmented and peeled out. However, as Dr. Sinha was saying, with the advancement in machine and cutter technology in terms of speed, port optimization and duty cycle, things have changed drastically. I'll repeat it shortly, although Dr. Sinha has spoken of this. Talking of the changes, coming first with the cutter speed, has improvement in cutter speed really made a big difference? In this high magnification, slow motion video comparing cut rate and tissue movement, I would request you to take a note in the difference, the amount of tissue pulled per cycle between the 1000 and the 2500 cuts per minute, and the difference between 2500 and 5000 cuts per minute. Obviously, the higher the cut rates, then the lesser the tissue pulled per cycle. Therefore, at higher cut rates, surgeon feels less traction on the retina due to less tissue drag per cycle with lesser possibility of iatrogenic breaks. Port optimization, the cutting ports of the vitrectomy probes have got closer to the tip, and this has allowed better access, making shaving close to the retina easier and safer. Duty cycle, as we all know, is the ratio of the on time compared to the total cycle time, and it's noted as a percentage. In machines like the Constellation, you can vary the duty cycle for any given to cut rate. In the core mode, it's a maximum open port duty cycle, and in the shave mode, it's a minimum open port duty cycle. From a practical viewpoint, this offers the surgeon the ability to control flow independent of cut speed and vacuum. In this graph, please note the difference in the open time between the two duty cycles for the same cut rate. For example, at 2000 cuts per minute, the difference between the core mode and shave mode is 40% in terms of open time of the cutter. This variable duty cycle allows cutter to be used as a vertical scissor or phragmotome, making it a multi-purpose instrument. Because of these advancements in machine and cutter technology, the need for forceps and scissors have drastically come down, and a lot of membranes, tough or delicate, can simply be shaved. Shaving is either conformational, where peeling conforms to the posterior concavity of the eye, or rollback, where the membrane rolls back into the cutter. Most of the cases can be managed unimanually. That's one active instrument in the one hand, and the other hand only holds the light back. But in some cases you need proportional reflux, where a water reflux creates a cleavage plane for membrane dissection, viscodissection, where viscoelastics are used to help create a dissection plane, and bimanual technique with two active instruments in either hands, and things like self-retaining torpedoes have greatly helped us go bimanual. Now I'll show you a few videos of some surgical cases. Yeah, starting with the case of pre-retinal fibrosis with TRT. Shubhendu has shown a case similar to this before, but repetition only helps understand and see things better. So we have created an opening with a needle which could be bent at the tip if you are wary of using it as a straight one. And once the opening is created, the cutter is used to shave off the membranous posterior highlight and the fibrosis. And of course, this is conformational shaving which is being done here. There is a slight lifting action while we are shaving, conforming to the posterior concavity of the eye. It's totally avascular. The small gauge vitrectors with port operation, that's port closer to the tip as I was showing, has made this technique possible. Good patience and good focus is the key for any VR, more so in diabetic cases. Next. here in this mid-peripheral area, as you are noticing, that the underlying retina is very thin with broad adhesions, and there is no cleavage plane, and this necessitated retinectomy in this mid-peripheral area. But once you have created a break, you have to ensure that there is no residual traction around it. The residual fibroid over the disc, of course, is of no harm and can be left alone. Controlled aggression is key for diabetic PR cases. This is another case which is a premacular fibrosis, a thick one. Again, we are using shaving and conformation shaving at this moment. If you go straight, you will hit the retina. You have to always come a little up while shaving, because you have to conform to the posterior concavity of the back surface of the eye. Now we are doing roll back technique. The membrane rolls back into the gutter and gets engaged into the gutter, and we can shave it. It's pretty simple actually with these modern day cutters. Here macula is now visible. In case of diabetic retinopathy sandwich with TRDs, probably it's good to push in a torpedo because it allows you to go bimanual and of course improves the illumination. The bridging traction nasally is released bimanually. A timely cautery is key in diabetic VRs. Liberal use of ramucirumab is advocated. Nasal traction without any plane of separation may be left alone, or RR may be done to remove it, as I am doing it here. Again, remove all surrounding traction if you have created any break by intention also here. And since there is no residual traction, air or gas tamponade is enough. You of course need to laser around the break. This is a case of advanced DR with combined RD. This is not a walk in a park case. The small gauge cutters with port optimization is what is helping us in a big way. There is an underlying detachment, mind you, in this case. As Dr. Sinha was showing, and even I showed, that these cutters, these high-speed cutters, are not just fancifully faster, but they cause much less tissue drag, and with the duty cycle variation which we can do, things have improved. So we are doing FE followed by endolaser. This case of course needed an oil tamponade. This is an organized dense vitreous hemorrhage. And what do we find once we have cleared the blood? The posterior pole is covered with fibrovascular proliferation, with no plane of cleavage. Again, good focus and patience is the key. No heroisms, please. Some would, of course, want to go bimanual in such a case. And some would probably try viscodissection or proportional reflux also in such cases. Regarding proportional reflux, somehow I found that it's probably more useful when you have focal, multifocal adhesions, and it doesn't work that well when you have broad-based adhesions. And where you have multifocal adhesions, anyway, there is a plane of cleavage, and with experience you can use that to your advantage and shape without the need of proportional reflux. But I'm not saying that I have anything against proportional reflux. You should all give it a try. Experience teaches when and where not to venture further. So PRP is done, followed by gas endotamponade. This is a case of diabetic combined detachment. We plan to go bimanual. The fibrovascular proliferation is lifted up with an engripping forceps. Be gentle, be have a controlled lifting action. Don't get over aggressive. And the membrane is being cleaned up with bimanual technique. If you pull too hard, you will cause iatrogenic breaks all around. And it's not just preretinal traction, but also the subretinal traction which needs to be relieved. And even if there is a retinal shortening, which is called retinal traction, intraretinal traction, that also needs to be relieved with the help of retinectomies. See, there was a subretinal bag here which was removed. This is a residual membrane in the nasal quadrant which is removed. Timely cautery, as I have been mentioning and my previous speakers also mentioned, is very important. This while being FG, we noted a subretinal band and that too was removed. So endolaser is done. And of course, you need to follow up with silicone oil tamponade. In cases of advanced DR with florid neovascularization, it's probably a good idea to use anti-VEGF adjunct. But what is important is the timing post using the anti-VEGF adjunct. It's best done between 3 to 7 days post using the intravitreal anti-VEGF. The anti-VEGF, of course, would reduce the vascularity of the proliferations. And studies have shown, and we ourselves also presented a paper at the academy where we showed that it reduces the number of instrument exchanges that you do. It reduces the surgical time, it reduces the need for endocauteries, it reduces the need for silicone oil tamponades, it also reduces the possibility of post-operative vitreous hemorrhages. Dr. Jantago was talking of the stable IOPs of the new machines help removing the thick proliferation over the underlying detachment. It gives you a very stable feel. Again, rollback technique in action. Things much better than what we had started with. And the retina is settled under air. PRP and endolaser are on the breaks here are performed, and silicone oil tamponade is a better option in these advanced cases. Thank you for your attention and listening.